Hey guys, Wes Gardner here from Brothering Around, and today's podcast is brought to you by Audible.com. For you, the listeners of the Brothering Around podcast, Audible is offering a free audiobook download with a free 30-day trial to give you the opportunity to check out their service. All sorts of books. You have over 180,000 to choose from. It works on your Kindle and your Android and your MP3 player. It probably works on like a microwave nowadays. Who even knows? But to download your free audiobook today, go to audibletrial.com/brotheringaround. Again, that's audibletrial.com/brotheringaround for your free audiobook courtesy of your boys. You know you got the hookup from here at Brothering Around. Oh man, it's that time, baby. It's that time.
Is that Dusty Rhodes?
It's that. Listen here, Daddy. It's that time. Let me tell you something about Ric Flair. Ric Flair ain't seen no hard times, baby.
Oh, dude. Dusty Rhodes just appeared at the podcast.
He did. That's why he's got a bicycle. Dude, I'll tell you what, man. Jay Lethal has the best impressions.
Jay Lethal. I love TNA Jay Lethal.
Oh my God, Black Machismo that was on point. His Ric Flair was perfect. I wish I could do a good Ric Flair. Like my Dusty Rhodes is okay. Like sometimes it's kind of hit or miss, but it's serviceable. Like you can tell who it's supposed to be. But like he does a Jimmy Hart impression. Come on, baby. It's hysterical. I can't even do it. Like, it's so, he's like, get on him, baby. Like, it's just, oh my God. But it made me want to go watch more Jimmy Hart matches. The old mouth of the South right there.
Mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart.
Oh, it's like, man, I'm talking to the Hulkster, baby. He would just always say stuff like that. Oh, ridiculous.
I always wondered why Hulk picked him to be a manager.
Yeah, and it's like Hulk was never bad on the mic.
I'm curious. Yeah.
You know, he didn't really need a mouthpiece, but I wonder if that was kind of the perfect thing. You know, I wonder if it was sort of a kind of get the rub, the same way that CM Punk picked Paul Heyman for a while to speak for him. And you're like, really? You have Paul Heyman to speak for a guy who's like amazing on the mic, but it worked because he was a heel. So, like, what better thing to do than like, yeah, I know I'm good on the mic, but I don't even have to talk. You know, like,
that's true. That's true.
Oh man, so we.
How are you feeling? How are you feeling? You sound a little better.
Yeah, it's a little better. It's that now. It's at that weird kind of. We've hit the like late last week. I think after we recorded, probably Thursday or Friday, I was like the most sick, like coughing and all that stuff. And then it's kind of on the downswing. But now I feel better. But like it was that nagging little bit, just that little extra. You're
coughing
stuff up, and you're like, where'd this come from? So it's like, I think I'm better, but now my body's like fully getting rid of everything. So
you're summoning jitsus you don't even know you had.
That's right, yeah. The evil is leaving me, and it's just in napkins all around the central Texas area. Right.
Oh, man.
Oh, but okay, so got to open with the big news. You know, fiance and I decided, you know, because family's going to come visit in the next few days for Christmas and holidays. And so, like, okay, let's do our gift exchange early, right? So, we do our gift exchange, and like the big reveal is she was like, okay, well, this is technically your birthday present. My birthday's in January, January 15th. Mm-hmm. She's like, this is technically your birthday present, but I wanted you to have it now. And I was like, okay, great. So she hands me a piece of paper, and it's a Ticketmaster receipt for NXT TakeOver San Antonio.
Nice.
Yeah, man. Main event is going to be Shinsuke versus somebody. Don't know yet. I think they had a Final Four today, or a Fatal Four match for number one.
Oh, you don't know who the person is?
I don't, but they're advertising Bobby Roode.
I know who it is.
You see the results, or you get to watch it?
I mean, that may have been like a house show advertisement, but it looks a little glorious.
Oh, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
It looks a little glorious.
A little glorious. Yeah. Yeah, and they're advertising Joe, Asuka, let's see, Johnny Gargano and Tommy Ciampa. Those are the only six right now. But Lord knows at the takeovers. And it's the night before the Rumble. So I'm wondering if somebody's gonna debut. You know what I mean? Like, that'd be a time to do it.
Right. I need to get back into watching WWE.
Yeah.
I have shows backed up, but then I'm just offline. Netflix is doing it for me.
Yeah. Right. Okay. So how does that work? I haven't actually used the offline Netflix. So like, do you select a video that you want? Like, I want to download this episode of, you know, Young Justice, and then you like click it, and then it saves it as a MP4, or like, how does that?
So as far as I know right now, that when you open up Netflix on your app, you go to available for download. So not everything that's available is available for download.
Oh,
so
I see.
I luckily enough, Terrace House was available to download. That's how I was able to get through two seasons of it. And then, it's a big selection, but then again, it's not everything that they have right now.
Like, gotcha.
That's for this month.
Yeah.
So, there is a range of it, but it's a pretty good range. So, you know, like I said, I got Terrace House, and then today I watched Kickboxer Vengeance, that new Kickboxer movie. Oh,
fantastic. Who's the star
of that? I could talk a little bit about it.
Who's the star of
that? Dave Bautista stars in that. It's not too bad. You download whatever you're going to watch, and then I was kind of trying to look for it like in like files, you know, in like you know how you would look in like a computer sense. You go to My Computer, like files, stuff like that. I was trying to do that through my phone, but I can't. So I guess you have to only play that through the Netflix player.
Oh, gotcha. Okay. So it's what do they call it? Kind of a locked in, probably kind video of format style.
Yeah.
Almost like how Real Player used to work way back in the day.
Oh, gosh. Real Player. Jeez.
Oh, that was for the you kids that are too young to remember the very first of the internet. Holy shit, Real Player was a disaster.
That was like video clips you can't download, but they had to buffer almost stream-like, but it wasn't live.
Yeah, that was it was really weird. Yeah, it is funny that you mentioned that, because it is almost like the precursor to video streaming. But it was shitty. Mm-hmm. Like, it never, ever worked. Ever. Real Player would just sit there, and then it would be a 30-second video, but it wouldn't like buffer and load the same way, let's say, a YouTube video would, to where it would load up the video, and if you just waited for a few minutes and then hit play, then it was in high def, or like, however, if you had throttled internet. Mm-hmm. Like, it would just buff the next 3 seconds.
And then it would buff again.
Yes, right. And then it would play those 3 seconds, and then buffer the next 3 seconds, and then buffer. Like, it was dreadful. And I mean, you had dial up internet, because everyone had dial up at the time. And so
you had to make the choice. Yeah. You had to make the choice if you want to stop it first and let the whole thing load so you can watch it in one sitting, or watch it as it buffers live and then wait. Yeah,
it was so bad.
You had to make like Telltale Games decisions with Real Player.
I'll tell you how far back this was, and this is going to date, I think, both of us incredibly, is this was the day to where there was no GameSpot.com. It was videogames.com, and it was bought by I think, like, CNET, and then the other main website for video game coverage, and I'm going to say this name, and you're going to burst out laughing, was Cheat Code Central. It was cheatcc.com.
Cheat Code Central.
It was like the preliminary to video game 24/7, or like I'm trying to think of like something like NeoGAF was not even nowhere near anything. And like, even Penny Arcade forums, I've been on the Penny Arcade forums for like 13 years. Those were not a twinkle in the eye. like that, those weren't even close to existing yet. Like this was, it was cheat. Oh, it's before GameFAQs. So Cheat Code Central like siphoned off. And I think part of it kept for Cheat Code Central, because this was also back in the day to where if you go to the grocery store and you go and you look at the video game magazines, they always had a really shitty cheat code book. Like the ones that were really tall and they were like neon green. And it was like, the hottest codes for the Super Nintendo. And then you would buy it. And it's the same codes that the other book had. And there's another one that's like blue and red. And it's like, oh, no, that other one's lying. This is the best one. Like, but it's all the same.
Dude, tips and tricks was my go-to.
That's it. Yeah, yeah. So, like, you had EGM, you had tips and tricks. You had a game fan. You had Game Pro, yes. Man, there was some, and you look back on those issues now, and there, it's a ton of nostalgia, but it was 98% advertisements. Like, there was hardly a word written in those magazines. It was just these pictures and, like, be sure to pre-order the Sega Saturn. Like, those advertisements.
Yeah, it would take me, I remember taking, it would take me a good month to go through a regular EGM magazine. Just because I wasn't even reading the articles, I was just looking at the video game, you know, pictures and advertisements, right? So when I actually start to read it, I was like, oh, this is pretty interesting. I was like, oh man, there's a lot of pages, a lot of words. And I would have to take, I would have to cut off a time of like my day just to, okay, I'm going to read what's big in arcades in Japan type of thing, or what does Sushi X has to say for about the reviews of these games. And yeah, it's...
So funny. You know, they still haven't revealed, even after all these years, who Sushi X was on the staff.
I know, I think he's on Twitter and I'm following him, but I don't think he says much.
Yeah.
I either keep missing if he does tweet out or he just hasn't said much. But
like, yeah, because apparently, I think what I'd like to think is it was EGM's version of Tiger Mask. Like,
oh, yeah.
You gave it to the new freelancer. Sushi X was like the persona. And you have to earn your stripes, and then you're introduced. Like, that's the way I like to think of it. Sushi X was like the aura.
Totally.
Like, here's how you learn how to write for Electronic Gaming Monthly.
Oh, man.
But, oh, there was some old school stuff back then. Like, we could... Hell, okay, so we'll talk about this real quick. And do you have the one question ready? Do you have it ready?
I do have one question ready, but I wanted to just... catch up on like how was your week?
It was solid. I made all these fancy plans to start doing my editing on the videos, and I haven't touched any of it. I haven't. I have footage for these games, but I still don't know what order my game of the year list is going to be. I need to record voiceover. I need to record the opening. I need to do the After Effects stuff. I need to like put it all together, which takes a lot of time, and I've just been super lazy.
Yeah.
Like, ridiculously lazy on it. It's just something I need to get into gear and just get it done. Because I feel bad. I haven't posted anything on the YouTube in, like, hell, the last commie log was 13 weeks ago, 14 weeks ago, you know? Wow.
Okay.
So, I mean, because, I mean, I stopped doing commie log whenever we started up Brethren Around.
Right, because that was before this. Comilog was
I got three episodes in, and I have a plan for another one. Like, it'd be easy to do. I just don't know what I'd talk about, because everything I want to talk about, we talk about here.
Yeah, that's a little bit of a struggle.
You don't want to step on the same toes, you know?
Right.
But yeah, just need to work on that. I think I'm starting to get kind of the numbering down on those, so. It should be done soon. It probably won't even be posted before this year is up, but I think it'll be something like first or second week of next year, Game of the Year 2016. Cool. And that would make more sense anyway, because I hate these things like, let's talk about Game of the Year in October. And you're like, there's still 2 months left, bro. Like, you still got, you know, not a lot of games, but I mean, you still got like 7 or 8 games that still aren't out yet.
The funny thing is, Super Best Friends, they do their Game of the Years, but they do it like, say like they want to talk about Game of the Year 2016, they'll put it out like in like August 2017.
Oh yeah, well, like, see, this is that's my Game smart. Of
the Year for because like they know they have to do it, but you know they have that regular rotation of like whatever videos they're doing or the games that they're doing. So they're doing that, and they have their other like side projects of like box art critique or like one-offs. And Game of the Year is like not on the priority. So
yeah,
it's just a running gag that they'll do like the last year's Game of the Year on like this year. So like I think they're still doing 2015 if they haven't released that yet for this year.
Oh, that's great.
Well, next year is going to be like way forward. Like this is going to be like 2016 Game of the Year up in like in November 2017.
I mean, there is something nice to think about with that, because with, and you know this as well, like whenever something comes out and it's immediately awesome, you kind of get blindsided, and then you may rate it better than what it's really worth. You know what I mean? It's the same thing for the hype. Yeah, totally. You're hyped up. You're like, okay, this is by far the best thing. And then, because I've had this happen to me before, to where like I'll look back on years previous and I'll be like, man, I think I got my list wrong. Like now looking back, I way prefer my number four game than my number one game, or you know, something like that. Just you can't tell. You can only be as accurate as you are on the day that you record. Like that's sort of how it is. Exactly. Like, you know, you can't know how you're gonna feel about it a year from now. I still feel real glad that we picked Mass Effect 2 as our game of the year, because I'm still like, yeah, that's that would be game of the year on like pretty much any year. You know, I'm looking back on, I was thinking, oh well, I wonder if I should do a top 10 games of the decade type thing. Like,
do a
massive list. You know what I mean? Like one of those big weight behind it and line in the sand type stuff, and cause a bunch of YouTube fights. Because that's all those are really for, is to cause YouTube drama.
Yeah, another cool way that I've heard people do on podcasts is they do like like March Madness, like how people would predict or make a bracket, and so whatever subject that they do, like say the March Madness bracket of like games. Of like action games or something. So they'll name games and they'll do it like a March Madness basketball, college basketball bracket with seeds and all. And then they'll go through the list and see between, I guess, like the three or four of them, which game would progress forward. And then they eventually get to like their number one. But they were like, it would often be like an argument, because, you know, either half of the people like this game or the other half of people like this game.
Yeah.
So it basically almost, every time that they did it, it was almost like a Game of the Year podcast every episode. But,
right.
But they got it down to where they just did it fast. And if they had a little bit of an argument, then they'll do it, but it'll be quicker rather than how you guys did it before.
Yeah, those deliberations, man.
Yeah, talk take all at day. Length. Yeah.
Yeah, like, and that's a good way to do it. And like, I do think that there's something about waiting to post it, because all these people doing it early, I just don't think you get a good feel for it. Like, I don't think you get a good feel was, okay, well, if the new expansion for The Witcher 3 came out, you know, a month ago, and, you know, you have all this stuff, and then you get into that weird thing is, okay, the expansion for The Witcher 3 is bigger than any other game on the Game of the Year list, but since it's an expansion, it doesn't count. So is that something that you do for your honorable mentions, or do you put it on the list anyway? Because you don't want people to like receive your content and be like, Game of the Year, this is an expansion pack, and people are like, that doesn't make any sense. But then some people are all for it, and then you start getting down that weird slippery slope of, you know, people are going to argue what a video game is, because some people just don't think adventure games, like, you don't even play it. You just pick dialogue and it plays it out for you. Like, then you get the way
So that example of expansions, that is something we can, but people can do as like March Madness brackets, like Final Fantasy 14, pick an expansion going up against Witcher 3, that expansion. And then,
Oh, right.
And then whoever progresses, and then you know, then the next matchup, and then they'll talk about, yeah, like I said before, it was basically a pretty cool idea. That's like, you have to shoot from the hip though. Cause you either like what you like, or, I mean, if you want it deliberate, that's fine. But if you're going to be doing this like every episode, you got to like be quick about it too.
Yeah. You got to make a decision and stand by it. And yeah.
Yeah. Totally. Yeah. So, okay. So you got that going.
Yeah.
Like, are you watching anything? You're playing anything?
We did watch some more, Terrace House. We are now.
Oh, where you at?
Let's see. We just wrapped up the, and this is going to sound really weird for people that don't watch it, but, the meat incident.
Oh my goodness.
And here's the deal. Both me and my fiance totally on Uchi's side on this.
Like, really? Okay.
Yeah, man. Well, you don't do that shit. A little bit of context.
I get it.
You know what I'm saying? Like, okay, a little bit of context for listeners.
All right, let's talk about this.
Okay, we'll just talk about the meat incident right now. Okay.
Yeah.
So, so a guy named Uchi on the show, he's a hairdresser, he's a stylist, he works with professionals like models and contractors and all this stuff. So he gets a gift from a client. They were really impressed with his work. They have such a great time. They traveled. I don't know how far the distance was, because I don't, my geography, hell, my geography for America is terrible. So in Japan, it'd be the worst. But basically, these clients made a very long trip to come specifically to see Uchi at his hairdresser salon, stylist salon. And they were so thrilled with the job and it was worth the trip that they mailed him like specialty steaks, because they were like a meat market or something. Like, I still don't understand how the relationship worked, but they sent him like really good looking steaks. You look at these things and you're like, these things aren't cheap, man. So the other roommates, one of them being his girlfriend, decide on a night that Uchi isn't home just to take these steaks out and cook them. And, like, apparently they were just, like, specialty steaks and they have to be cooked a certain way and all this other stuff, and had a really long grateful note with it. And so Uchi comes home. He sees an empty meat box. Like, everyone's like, oh, those steaks are great. So just on that level, like, that's shitty. Like, you ate that guy's fucking food while he was at work, and then he comes back and he can't have any because there's none left. Like, just that's shitty. But then, you know, he was very much like, this was from a client and they were very impressed with my work. And I told them that I would save this. And, you know, this is more than just like a few steaks. This is professional, you know, decorum. And he was very like, what the hell? Like, and I got it, man. I was like, you don't do that, man. Cause you're not just disrespecting the guy for eating his food. You're disrespecting his work, because that's one of the rewards he got for a job well done.
Yeah.
But then everybody, the cast, then the moderators that like are the commentators that watch it as well, all thought he was being ridiculous. And I was like, I'm with him, man. Like, I think he's on point right now. Like, yeah, he was upset, and you come to find out that it was just all this built up stress and anger and anxiety from living with everybody, and you know.
Okay, so, I was gonna ask, like, did you get to the conclusion of that?
Yes. Then you know, you thought for a second that, oh, this could be a big thing between Uchi and his girlfriend, because here's the thing. And whenever this happened, this is the first place my mind went. And I don't know if this says more about me and my experiences, or I was like, oh, she did that on purpose. Because the night before, the night before, they had a talk to where Uchi was like, you know, you need to be more dedicated. You just sit around a lot. And then she didn't take very kindly to it. So I thought she was like, well, bitch, if you think I'm not worth it, I'm going to cook your steaks while you're at work.
Yeah.
That's what I thought. That was the first place my mind went. I was like, oh, she hit him where it hurts. None of that, the commentators didn't pick up on that. Like, nobody did. So I was like, well, maybe that just says my shitty luck in the past. Like, that my mind went there first, you know? But so what do you think about the whole meat incident? Because you sounded surprised that I was on Uchi's side.
So, okay. So, like, when that happened, the meat incident happened, I was like, damn, that's pretty messed up. I mean, well, like, how they presented it, I was like, oh, hey, yeah, Uchi got like some meat as like a reward. And it was the girlfriend whose idea, like you said, to cook it.
Yeah.
So like the rest of the roommates are, who's going to oppose of like eating good meat, right? Because I guess that's more of a rare thing over there, right?
Yes. Yeah.
So they didn't, they, yeah, like, it's, like you said, they come to eat it and it's, it was great and all. And yeah, Uchi comes home and finds out it's all gone. And in like the title information, I guess before you're about to play it, like play the episode, mm-hmm. it says that Uchi was furious, right?
Yeah.
But I watch it and like, I just see like, he was just like dead.
Yeah, like the emotion, it sucked the life out of him.
Yeah, it sucked the life out of him. Like the emotion that he was feeling in the show, then from like the words that it was described, like I was expecting him to be yelling and all that stuff, but he was just quiet. He was just like, I'm done. Like, I'm pretty sure his feeling was like, I'm done with this place. I want to get out of here.
He just gave up. He was like, whatever.
Yeah. So, yeah, I understand. I understand at that point. And that sucks for the girlfriend to just think about like, oh, hey, yeah, my boyfriend got this meat as a reward. Let's all go eat it without him.
Yeah, right.
Without him there, right? I thought that was messed up. I think the thing that made me think like, okay, Uchi's kind of going too far about this is because it wasn't about the meat, right?
Yeah.
But because that happened, that was like the thing that tipped him over into like being super emotional about everything. Because like you said, the girlfriend is not like really as like career driven in a sense like Uchi or the rest of the people are. And I retweeted a picture because I went to the hashtag Terrace House.
Yeah.
And I saw the picture of the girlfriend saying, I can live forever by doing nothing.
Yep.
Or something like that.
Yep.
I was like, you know what? Yeah, that's totally you.
Yeah. Yeah, so, absolutely.
Yeah, so like, yeah, that happens, and Hikaru was, you know, he was the first person to say like, "I'm really, really sorry."
Which I thought was good. Like, he's the youngest guy in the house, but he had the balls enough to like go meet him face to face. Because at this point, Uchi is like away from everybody in this bed, and he doesn't want to talk to anybody. So like, homie goes into the room. And he's like, "Listen, man, I didn't know that it was off limits. I apologize. It was disrespectful." But do you need to get so angry? Like,
That's what I was gonna get to. Like, it might have been the way Uchi said how he got the meat without like clearly saying, "Please don't eat this," or you know, "Cook this," or whatever to his roommates. Because I'm pretty sure if it's just sitting there without like any kind of note, it's up for grabs.
Right. Yeah. It's up for grabs
in a group setting.
Yeah.
In a group living setting. Right. Because that's pretty much the same thing happening at my work. Like, if there's some sort of food in there and that your name is not on there, and there's a bunch of us, pretty sure it's going to be gone
by the time. Right.
And we don't know who's going to be. Like, I know it's not me because I don't do that, but pretty sure somebody has like grabby fingers and just willing to eat or snack on everything that's there. So like, that's the thing that we need to watch out for. And like, Uchi didn't think he needed to do that, but at the same time, you're living with other roommates and strangers.
Yeah, or, right. You got to be aware of your surroundings.
You don't know your boundaries, and you don't know how who is going to be like. And like, Armin was like, "Oh, like he," Armin was like, "Oh, really? He's mad about that?" He started laughing about it. Like, "Oh,
he did."
I thought that was hilarious, but yeah, like it ended up becoming a whole bigger thing because the girlfriend, not career driven, and like I guess he was bottling up things inside, but like the way he poured out on it, like when he exploded, I saw none of the, I guess, American explosion that I would think I would see, right?
Right. Yeah, like the pointing of the fingers, and you want to flip the table over
and like trying to like make fights and stuff, but he was just depressed and because it really meant something to him. And I totally get that. That thing was like a reward to him, and for with the girlfriend to just say, "Hey, let's just go eat it because it's there." like, that's pretty thoughtless of him, thoughtless of her.
Yeah, and, right, right.
And then, like, there was a little tiny moment where, like, I think she was thinking, I made the bad decision to picking her over the other two or something.
Right. Yeah.
You remember he did the three dates.
That's right.
And like, they were talking about that, and I guess Uchi, not cover his tracks, but like, he gave a passable answer to the girlfriend, saying like, that's not what that's about, but it's just because they think it was supposed to be all happiness and all that stuff once after they became a couple, but like, things like this happened.
Yep.
Yeah, it was hilarious. I think the comedian was saying that, like, I think this may be the first time we ever got a breakup over a food incident.
Yeah, over meat.
yeah.
And I'll tell you who the real freaking MVP is, man, is Minori's older sister. Like,
yeah, right?
No matter what scene she comes in on, she fixes whatever problem there is. It's like she's a magician. Like, she'll go in there and she'll say three things to two people and it's done. Like, the whole thing's resolved. I'm like, I don't know what she does for a living, but she needs to be like a hostage negotiator or something, because like, she is killing it. She comes in and she's like, listen, she was like, so you're going to come in here and you're going to complain and you're going to be upset about the meat stuff, but you're not going to tell anybody why. That's exactly what you accused my little sister of doing, and you hate it, right? Mm-hmm. He's like, yeah. You know, and I was like, oh, what a genius move. Oh.
Right? The psychology.
She did, man. She could get in there. She gets in there, and she says, like, two or three things, and then she made everyone feel better. She even made her younger sister feel better, be like, I'm going to go, let me go talk to him. And then she goes in there, and then she comes back. She's like, yeah, it's all fixed. Go talk to him.
Oh, so like, I want to give you like a little bit of a heads up. You know how the new girl just moved in?
Yeah.
And she already started stuff with.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's going to be a continuing thing. So.
It seems like it will be. And it seems like right now it's just a personality clash. Like,
yeah.
But she'll say things, and she says things in a way that has no tact whatsoever. Mm-hmm. Like, she's like, oh, you guys seem like a dumb couple or something. Like, she'll say something like that. And you're like, what the fuck? Like, but she'll just say things and then people will call her out. And she's like, I didn't mean it like that. And you're like, what do you mean you didn't mean it like that?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Just to give you a heads up.
It's ridiculous. She appears to be, And see, I thought there was going to be a little beef during the whole meat incident. Because, pun intended, I guess. But, so she's the first girl to go into the room. Not Minori or not the older sister, but other girl. I can't remember her name. Like Naga-chan or something.
They call her,
She goes in there.
Naga-chan or something like that.
Yeah, yeah. So she goes in there and she's like, okay, what's going on? You know, I didn't have any of the meat. Can you please explain to me all this other stuff? Basically talking to Uchi, and Uchi's like, well, we don't really talk. You and I don't really talk, but this is how I felt, and this is why I feel upset. The girl's like, okay, I'll give you three options. Either you can come downstairs or come upstairs and say hi to everybody, or Minori's older sister can come up and talk to you, or you could just go back to sleep and not do anything. And then he's like, okay, fine, I'll talk to her older sister. So she girl goes upstairs and she was like, oh, well, Uchi told me this and this and this and this. And then Minori, without batting an eye, is like, well, why would he tell you that and not me? And I was like, oh, shit, there's going to be more drama because now she's all, why are you talking to my man? And why is my man talking to you?
Right. Oh, man. Were you still enjoying it, though?
Yeah. Oh, it's good. I will say that. We're all in. Totally all in.
Yeah.
I will say another one of the true MVPs is the supervisor at the construction company. The long-haired dude that has the goatee. You could tell he is the man. Like, you could just tell by his demeanor and all this stuff, and like the way he says stuff, because he's talking to Armand, And he's like, so Armand, because Armand starts working at
the plant boss.
Yeah, yeah. So
yeah, he starts, that guy's cool. Yeah.
No, that guy's just that guy's legit. Cool. Like the true brother that guy is. So he's like, hey Armand, like you started working for us. You know, whenever I went to Hawaii, everyone was lazy, but you're the hardest worker we got. So thank you for your service. Yeah. You know, and Armand's like, thanks, man. He was like, so Armand, how's the house treating you? You know, how's it going? And they're like, eh, I guess it's okay. It's like, oh, if you've been talking to, how's that one girl? How's she doing? And it's like, well, you know, I kind of got rejected and all that stuff. And he's like, ah, whatever. And he was like, no.
By the way, that rejection was all messed up. Like, she wasn't clear whatsoever.
Oh, yeah. Oh, and they during the meat incident episode, they rewatched that episode on Netflix.
Yes, they did. Oh, exactly. So that's the thing that we were talking about.
Imagine.
They'll watch their own episodes, like, as it comes out, but the audience is only privy, like, only like exposed to what's out. So, like, yeah, you know, what we're watching is going to be ahead. What they're watching is like it's a little behind if they're doing like a week to week type of thing. But
which is really, really interesting because now they get information that they may not have had before.
Yeah.
You know, but yeah, the head supervisor guy, he's like, hey, you dated Mizuki as well, right? And then he's like, yeah. He was like, what you need to do is you need to settle down. He's like, it's fun to date a bunch of girls, right? And he's like, yeah. He's like, it's way more fun to fall in love with one girl.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, good man. Listen to that sage advice right there. Like, that's a good, that's a brother right there. Like, you're telling him like it is. But then he's like, but you won't listen to me because you're a player. And I burst out. I lost it.
He knew.
Of course he does. Like, he is the old sage wise man. You. Like, he's the man. Like, all these, like, slight bit characters end up being the glue that holds it all together for me. Like,
yeah.
So good.
Oh,
and, like,
man,
all of the sassy girls at the hair place that work with Uchi.
Yeah.
They're like,
yeah,
well, tell me what's going on with so and so. Like, they're all as sassy as you would think. Like, you couldn't typecast sassier people. It's just awesome.
Yeah. Totally. Oh, man.
Terrace House, good stuff. Good stuff. Terrace House. Was you? Anything fun happening on your week?
So like you, finished off Terrace House. Extremely sad that I have nothing like that to watch until, like, Aloha State comes out.
Is that not on yet? Because I could have sworn I saw a thing for it. On Netflix.
They have a thing that's up, but there's nothing showing. So, like, I mean, the end of the last episode of season two, it's like, yeah, everybody's leaving, and then it says in Oahu, Hawaii, and then it says Terrace House, and you're like, oh man, they're gonna do it in Hawaii.
Blam.
So they have a thing up, but there's nothing yet. There's no episodes out yet, and I believe they're airing it on Netflix Japan, but it's not on the States yet. So, finished that. Yeah. Like I said, really sad. So I was like, what should I watch next? End up downloading or watching, Kickboxer Vengeance.
Yeah.
So like I gave a little preface of like how like super best friend's understanding of the movie was like the main character is all in the wrong. Cause like the brother just wanted to do it do it for himself. And the brother and the main character is like, no, you killed my brother. But everybody's like, no, he chose to do what he wanted to do. So like, I'm watching it now. I watch it today, and I'm like, okay, I kind of see what they're saying, but like at the same time, the brother is being a little arrogant about it because like, apparently he won like some gold medal of like, not of a non-descripted sport. It just sound like he won a gold medal in like. In the 90s kickboxing era type of thing. And then so he wanted to challenge like the Thai kickboxing champion like right away. And so like that's where he runs into Tong Po, which is played by Dave Bautista.
And then
like the opening scene, like the main character is like going into this temple. He's like, hey, I want to train with he said a different name than Tong Po, but that was the only time he said a different name. He's like, I want to train so-and-so.
Yeah.
And then, like, GSP is the doorman.
Oh, blam.
Yeah, George St. Pierre is the doorman, and he's a I guess in the movie here he's an alcoholic Thai kickboxer. So like he's drinking all the time.
Yeah.
So like yeah, they have their little fight, and then the main character gets in, and then let's see. Oh yeah, the main character goes in, and then there's a bunch of like students fighting around, and so once and so Tong Po apparently has a mouthpiece, kind of like Paul Heyman is to Brock Lesnar. So, so when they come to introduce Tong Po, the mouthpiece keeps saying, "Can I get an amen? Can I get an amen?" I was like, "Is Tong Po a religion? What's going on here?"
It's Jimmy Hart.
Yeah. It's Jimmy Hart. It's totally Jimmy Hart. It's totally
Paul Heyman. Get on him, baby. Stay on him.
Right. So yeah, I'm just watching. It's like, yeah, it's pretty corny, but like, I like what I'm watching. Like, but the weird thing was that when Van Damme shows up, when Van Damme has his lines, mm-hmm. like, a good maybe 50% of his lines, it's him, right? Him talking. Right. The other half, it's a dubbed voice of somebody else.
What?
So like, I don't know what's going on. I don't know what happened there. I don't know if Van Damme didn't want to say his lines with full projection, or it just the audio didn't sound right, or what, but they had to redub his voice whenever he had scenes half of the time. Huh. And then it's weird because it's the main character's little like fighting style before he transitions into kickboxing looks nothing like kickboxing. So he's doing his own thing, but I'm like, whatever. It's you know, random white guy, you know, knows martial arts, and he's gonna do whatever he's gonna do.
Yeah, right.
Then, I mean, I'm not gonna go through the whole movie, but it was like how scenes weirdly happen. So like, there was this cop lady that was there when the brother got defeated. Mm-hmm. Basically, the brother died, right, in the fight.
Right.
The brother died in the fight, so like the cop lady went to take care of the main character, and then when the main character decides he wants to fight Tong Po, the cop lady's like, you can't do that, and all of a sudden there's a sex scene. Like, wait, you didn't even establish the relationship. they just jumped to a sex scene right away.
You just know those executives are like, oh shit, we have 40 hours of footage and we need to make this an hour and 22 minutes.
Yeah, so like
put it all in.
No, they didn't have like no dates. They didn't like there was like no substance into it.
Hey, just, the heart wants what it wants, you. Man.
No,
the heart wants what it wants.
The heart or something else. What does it want? Yeah. So yeah, that was Kickboxer Vengeance. I rated it. I gave it like a 3 stars. It's like that corny, martial arts movie. It's like, yeah, you know what? I like it, but you're silly.
Right, it's like, all right, you did okay. It's funny because Batista has been in quite a few of these like kind of B-tier martial arts movies.
Yeah,
because he was in that one with the RZA.
Oh man, with the Iron Fist.
Yeah, or Golden Fist or something. He was in that one, and then he was made of gold, and
he was like the Kung Fu Colossus.
Yes, and he like punched people through walls.
Yeah.
He's like the Juggernaut. It doesn't make any sense. Like the whole thing. Yeah. And the RZA is like the grandmaster of everything, apparently. Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh, sure. Like, all right.
Yeah. I think, yeah. Def Jam. Def Jam the movie. That's what it was.
Yeah, exactly.
In the Kung Fu setting. You know? So, yeah. Yeah, watch Kickboxer Vengeance. Been playing Punch Club on my phone.
Ah, yeah.
So that game is fun. The game is fun. It's challenging though because there's stat decay every day. So like your stats are like strength, agility, and stamina. Strength is power of your hits. Mm-hmm. Agility is like, you know, how fast or like how often you can avoid hits plus accuracy. And then stamina is like your energy meter of like, you know, when you can use your attacks, how much energy that it uses. And mm-hmm. yeah, so like you're going through this like it's a full 80s and 90s reference video game like in the martial arts setting. So I don't want to get into too much of the story, but like, yeah, the stat decay is a pain in the butt.
That sounds pretty rough.
Yeah, like every day, like you lose a progression of whatever you're focusing on, and you can't be good in all three stats. You have to focus on one. Oh. So like, say like your build is a strength fighter, and then there's like three other save slots that you can use. So like I'm using an agility build, just so like I'm really accurate and I can move around a lot. But my secondary stat that I need to keep up with is stamina, because I want to keep using, like, I want to have the energy to be able to use techniques in my fights.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
So that's my thinking behind it. So, yeah, it's just, there's a lot of references to it. There's, like, the first person you meet is a guy named Mick. So, like, Mick from, like, Rocky, the coach. Right. There's the pizza owner in the game is Casey from, like, what's the Steven Seagal movie where he's a chef? Under Siege, something
yeah,
like that.
Yeah.
So like, yeah, he's the like the pizza maker, and then there's two people off to the side, and it's basically Pulp Fiction, Samuel L. Jackson, and what's his name? the other guy having like in a diner eating and something. So like a lot of references.
Yeah.
You're fighting ninja alligators, not ninja turtles, ninja alligators, because they have to change it up a little bit.
Right.
And yeah, it's a fun game. Very challenging because of the stat decay. But I'm just going through that, and you know, a little spoiler, I'm gonna be doing a little playthrough of that on the Ooh, on the channel. So
yeah,
expect that maybe on like January, like because I've recorded footage. I need to do the audio and
God, it's and a time it intensive there. Thing. Like
it is
for people that don't make content. As far as like the great thing about podcasts is they're pretty easy. It's a great way to get going and get started and making content. Yeah. But like video editing,
yeah,
oh, it's rewarding because whenever it's done, it's a brand new thing that couldn't have been done without you. You know, it has that sort of feel to it. But God, the amount of work it takes just for like, cause I even think I'm going to spend 30 to 45 seconds per game on 5 games. So my whole game of the year video is going to be 7 minutes long. Maybe that's still going to take 3 weeks
of footage.
Yeah. Right? Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Cause you have to find footage of, so the way I do it is I'll actually do the narration. Mm-hmm. Then I'll go and try to find footage that matches the narration. You know what I mean? Oh, like, man. If I mention, the menus are really easy, I'll go try to find footage for that timestamp of the 10 seconds of me going through a menu. Because you want to show and tell at the same time. Maybe I should look through all the footage and then make my words about what the footage is. And then, you know, work it from the other angle. But there's no right way to do it. Like, whatever your workflow is. So like you said, you already got footage. For the game, but now it's just about what do I want to say, and do I have footage that shows that off? And
yeah, I see. I come off like the totally opposite way, like where I need to watch whatever, like say whatever I recorded to make what my narration is.
Ah, interesting.
Yeah, so I'm from the opposite end, or at least I'm used to doing that because, like, for me to bring up narration without seeing anything, like read off anything or whatever, but I need something I need to see or just visualize to think about what the words I'm going to use. Like I can't just like look at a blank screen and just talk about whatever. Right. But then again, that's like, that could be like outlines of like these talking points. And then,
yeah. And probably the way you do it makes more sense because you're not going to go off on a tangent, you know, because you know what you're looking at. And, you know, that is the benefit of doing like a let's play is you're literally like when we did our bouncer let's play, we were riffing. It was Riff City.
Yeah.
But it was exactly what we're looking at on the screen. Like running commentary, it's really fun and it's pretty easy because all you have to do is have, you know, 30 years of jokes in the back of your head and then like try to fit them in at any given opportunity. But yeah, it's like those projects are a lot of fun, but even those, and you know, the Let's Play we did with the bouncer, it was pretty easy to record. It was a fairly painless process, if I remember right. And like, we didn't have a lot of technical difficulties. Maybe there was one or two things that kind of were weird, but other than that, I mean, the sound levels were good. I mean, it, you know, it went really, really well. And that was for a, you know, a 5-hour game. Like, I can't imagine these guys doing full Let's Plays. Like, I was doing a Let's Play for Breath of Fire 3. I'm doing a Let's Play for Final Fantasy 7. Those, those I don't mind doing because it's just me. And I know I, because I am the type that I could look at a wall and talk to you about whatever it is. If you give me a time limit and you give me a topic, I will go off and on a tangent. Yeah. So those long form RPGs are really good for that. And also like the how the sausage is made, where you like, let me go into the menu and check what I have equipped. And then I'll go into the menu and check what I have equipped. You know, you're going to tell them and then you're going to show them. But yeah, with these kind of videos of like how you do it on your channel, where you show, okay, here are the first, you know, 20-ish minutes, 15, 20 minutes of a mobile game. What am I thinking as the screen comes up? I know that these are the creators of it. This is what they did in the past. Here's what I'm expecting. And then you see the stuff like how the different meters, because all those cell phone games have some sort of daily reward. They have some sort, you know, there's a lot of these trends that carry over from game to game. But I like the fact that you go over like, oh, this is similar to this other game that we played because, you know, this is how it correlates and it's good stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, totally.
But
that's what you look at when you're making content.
Yep.
Basically, if you would decide you want to make a YouTube channel or go on Twitch or whatever.
Yeah, it's and the thing is, people, the biggest thing before we get into the what our main episode was going to be about, and then we'll reveal what really happened.
Oh yeah.
but what I always hear from people, and it's, you know, it could have been people that were starting in the Hobo Network, it could be people that just maybe are fans of Marco and I's that will ask us stuff, and the number one thing I know you probably hear the same thing, people are just nervous. Oh, I'm nervous to get a microphone. Oh, I'm nervous to have a webcam. Oh, I'm nervous for all this other stuff. And they're like, how do you not be nervous? And it's like, man, I'm always nervous. I'm nervous before we hit play on anything, before brothering around.
For sure.
Yeah, because, and this is something that was taught to me in public speaking class. If you're not nervous before talking or presenting something, either one of two things, either you're boring or you're a liar. One or the other.
Okay.
Like, those are the two things. If you say, oh, I'm not nervous at all, I'm going to go out there and it's going to be great, you're either going to be super boring or you will be a liar because you don't even believe the shit you're spewing. So, of course, you don't feel nervous because nothing you say means anything. So, So just don't be boring and don't be a liar. And you'll always be nervous, but you'll be better off for it. So just do it.
Yeah.
Just do it. Just do the thing.
Yeah.
Whatever the thing is. Whatever you think about, whatever, before you go to sleep at night, if you wake up in the morning still thinking about that thing, do it. Just do that thing.
Yeah.
Just do it.
Very much.
But, so, hilariously, we did our open questions over the past week, hashtag brothering around. You can ask us questions, you know, on Twitter, through the YouTube comments, any sort of way you wanted to get in touch with us. And we got one question.
We got one. Hey.
But hey, it's our boy. It's our boy.
Vampiric Warrior.
Our true brother, Vampiric Warrior.
Man. Shout out to you.
Twitch.tv/Vampiric Warrior. He's doing more Diablo 2 stuff. I know he's still big into Magic the Gathering. So if those two games, which are real good games, sound like your jam, go give our boy a follow. Tell him that Brother Around sent you.
Yeah. Twitter.com/HGVampiric.
That's right. HG Vampire.
His question, it's a pretty straightforward one. His question was, do you think that the Hardcore Championship will ever come back for WWE?
Wow.
In this day and age, do you think it will come back? That's what his question was. I was going to answer because he asked me on the Discord channel. Nerd in the Bay has a Discord channel. You can go to it. I'll send an invite link. You send out daily reminders. Hey, come through.
Yeah.
So yeah, he set the question on the Discord channel.
Yeah.
And yeah, so that's what he asked, and I was gonna answer right then and there, but he's like, oh no, you should. Like he said, wait to answer it so you do your, so you guys do your show. I was like, oh, thanks, looking out, vamp.
Yeah, so, the boy.
So yeah, this is our the question.
The question. And hey, that's good news because now we have tons of time to actually go into it. So okay, you go first on this one. It was asked to you on your Discord channel, so I want you to go first.
Yeah. Okay, so do I think that the Hardcore Championship will ever return? I don't think it'll come back into what it was started out to be in the Attitude Era.
Right.
I don't think it'll be ever be like that. If they tried to bring it back in a normal rotation, it would probably be like around the lines of like what post ECW looked like when it was the third show on the WWE, like it was on Sci-Fi or something. Mm. Like the ECW's like anything goes match type of thing.
Yeah,
I think it'll go like that. But I don't know. Like, there's an appeal of what it was back then of like you had to defend that belt 24/7.
Yeah, see, so you that's had where funny, I was going to go.
You had funny skits where like they'll go into like somebody's hotel room while they're sleeping and try to cover them.
Yes.
With the referee with them, and do like the referee will do like the softest like hand slaps.
Yeah, to not wake anybody up. Right?
Not wake anybody up. and like that's awesome. And or you have like WWE legends, like who did it? Who are the Vince McMahon's
Briscoe and Patterson.
Briscoe and Patterson, where I think Briscoe won the Hardcore Championship belt. Yeah. Patterson was like celebrating with him, and I think he knocked like a beer bottle or something over his head, and then Briscoe was knocked out, and then Pat Patterson just pinned him 1-2-3, and boom, Hardcore Championship.
Yep.
You know, so like that's the appeal that you like. It's like that would be pretty awesome, with the the cast they have now or the roster that they have now. Like, how would you like to see like Enzo, like, do some funny skit of like how to like that like Cass had the belt and he's gonna pin Cass because whatever,
right?
Like the skits range can be like endless or like especially with like the New Day or something like where you just have like funny people trying to get the belt in funny ways, like it'll be awesome, right?
That would be great.
Yeah, but I can't see it being as hardcore as it was. Those matches were like dumpster containers were being thrown off like a high ledge, and like you can't do head chair shots, at least in WWE,
right?
Due to like concussions. I just personally don't think it'll come back in that fashion, but maybe in what we see like the post ECW I think that's it for me. What do you think?
I mean that's exactly what I was gonna say, almost verbatim. Okay. Seriously, because I whenever I think Hardcore Champion now, that's a belt that screams Dean Ambrose. You know what I mean? Like, right. and the cool thing about the Hardcore Championship, like you said, it can have the goofy moments, but then if you wanted to actually build a pretty hype match around the Hardcore Championship, no DQ, you know, no disqualification, fall count anywhere, 30-minute time limit anywhere in the arena is on limits. You know what I mean? Like, you can do those. You could still do those now. In fact, you could do those arguably more effectively now than you could back then. Because now everyone kind of knows what backstage segments are like. Like you said, you get Enzo and Cass, you get New Day, you get some of these comedy bits that go in there and they can spice it up a little. But
yeah,
they can do it in a way to where, you know, the investors are still happy because there's no overt, like, crazy violence. Like you said, there's no more headshots with these things. Like, tables are all in, you know?
Yeah.
You can put somebody through a concession stand. Like, there's a lot to it. Hell, I think my favorite hardcore match, I think it was, was it Crash Holly versus, it's where they were at the Mall of America or whatever. And
okay.
They went through like a Chuck E. Cheese. And so they went into the ball pit and then they went like down the, down the slides. Just ridiculous. The whole match was stupid, but that's kind of what it was meant to be. Like, I think WWE needs a belt because this is totally aped from the DDT pro stuff. Like the Kota Ibushi putting fireworks in people's butt, like that type of this whole thing is ridiculous. But I think
an apartment building.
working his way up. But that's what I mean. Like, they could have a whole vessel to tell these ridiculous stories. And that gives, people that wouldn't normally be on TV. Like, I don't even know what the contract is right now with Adam Rose or Aldo Rose or whatever they call him.
They're trying to bring him back or something.
Yeah, from what I've seen, and I know his head's buzzed and all this stuff, but he's still the party guy. Like, that'd be a great belt for him to like do crazy stuff and like let me get somebody preoccupied during one of my crazy dance parties, and then you could fit in character development
funny enough the hardcore championship belt, like it gives you a chance to be creative through the skits, through like developing your character. So like I actually never thought of it that way till now. Like, yeah, because they were allowed to do a lot of things. And like the one thing I remember was when somebody got pinned. When somebody won the hardcore championship, somebody else that winner got pinned, and then he lost the hardcore championship. Like the championship like bounced around like in one sitting, like in one segment.
Yes.
Type of thing. I was like, yeah, like that happened. And I was like, yeah, like it's a refreshing take on like the regular have a match, build a story, and either
payoffs of the pay per view.
Yeah.
Right.
It changes the pace and stuff. So like it would be cool to have something like that back. And it would work in different ways than it would back then. But
right. Yeah. And then what's interesting is I wonder if the reason why they don't do it. I wonder if the reason why they don't do it, where would cashing in a money in the bank fall in that sort of idea? You know what I mean? Cause I wonder if that's related.
Is. Yeah. Cause
technically you cash in at any time, anywhere, 24/7. But no one does. They wait until Raw or the pay-per-view.
They wait
until
the show, yeah.
Yeah.
See, yeah, somebody needs to think about like the hardcore championship back in the day and do that and just record a segment where like say like Kevin Owens got into like a hit and run and like he's fine, but he's like really disoriented, but like the Money in the Bank winner beating him up and then pins him. Like that would be totally be like a awesome like take on a different take on the Money in the Bank, and then like
that would be hilarious.
And then the winner shows up and like we're like, wait, what? I thought Kevin Owens was the winner of the Universal Championship, but yeah.
Or like cause see, now that we talked about all these crazy dumb bookings and stuff, like that's a perfect belt for James Ellsworth to win.
Exactly.
Like he is the reigning defending hardcore champion, and then people keep trying to win it from him, but like something happens to where they like
way out or something.
Yeah, he always weasels his way out, or there was like an accident that happened on the way, so like they're running after James Ellsworth and then they hit their face on the door or like some dumb thing, and then that
And then they go to like a graveyard, and like James Ellsworth's like, they'll find me here. And then the Undertaker shows up, like, what the hell?
Oh my God. Right? Or it could just be just straight up WCW booking, and they can build monster trucks. And
yeah,
that I still cannot believe that was a thing that happened in WCW. They had Hulk Hogan versus the Giant in a monster truck match. And they just had fucking monster trucks. Like, what is happening right now? And then this was the same pay-per-view to where Hulk Hogan pushed the Giant off of a building and quote-unquote killed him. Like, ended the Giant's life. Then next pay-per-view, they got, not Bruce Buffer, but his dad, the Let's Get Ready to Rumble guy.
Oh, yeah.
They got him, and whenever the Giant walked out, if I remember right, the guy was hyping him. He was like, now coming in at 7'1", returning from the dead. Like, he said it in his open. And I was like, WCW, you're so shitty, and I love you so much.
Did you see, it might have been just on Facebook, but I don't know if it's out on other, like on YouTube or whatever, but there was a segment or a skit where Sting got hired to be the Cowboys.
The Dallas Cowboys.
Intimidation coach. I was like, dude, that's awesome. I wish, they should do more of that stuff.
Yeah. Oh, I agree. I totally agree.
Dude, that was funny.
It's good, man. He's like, cross promotion stuff.
Are we really going to do this every day? He's like, hey, what are you doing? He wants to check his bat.
It reminded me of back during the Attitude Era. Stone Cold Steve Austin went on Sports Center or did like those really funny Sports Center commercials to where Dan Patrick. Dan Patrick was at the table and he was just trying to write something and it just wasn't coming out. And Steve Austin's like, hey, what's the deal? And he's like, I don't know, man. I just can't concentrate. It's just not coming to me. So then Steve Austin grabs his steel chair and hits him in the back. And then he's like, there we go. And he starts like writing on the piece of paper. Just dumb gimmick stuff. Like, it's so funny. Oh, man. Yeah. But that was a good question, Vamp. I think there's room for it. Do I think it'll actually happen? Not soon. But, you know, the whole landscape is changing for WWE. I read an article today talking about these different, like, internet television, like Flow Slam and Powerbomb.tv. Mm-hmm. And like all these truly indie circuits, and that WWE is actually getting some of the rights for like a lot of UK stuff right now. So that's why they're having their UK invitational in January. And I'm excited because one of the guys I mentioned on a previous Brother and Around, the guy that wrestled Yuji Nagata and like did a hand slap. Trent Seven. He's going to be in it and he's my favorite going into it. I'm like, oh hell yeah. Trent Seven's going to be the man. Like, so Trent Seven's in there, Pete Dunne. There's quite a few guys in there. But yeah, I think it's going to be really good. I think it's going to be interesting how the WWE fans are going to like this kind of British, they call it British strong style. And it's like old school Finley and William Regal stuff.
Like catch wrestling?
Yeah, like shoot catch. Like a
you're
gonna win with like an elbow lock type stuff. Just really interesting. Of course they have the more performance stuff on there as well, so it is kind of the sports entertainment side. But these are the guys that are not afraid to do like handstand escapes out of things and like that old school World of Sport Luthez style, like it was funny. I was watching some old wrestling, and I'm talking 1950s stuff that they had on YouTube, like the old the World of Sport stuff was like early 80s, but it was kind of that natural progression of it. But Sayama, his name was Sammy Lee whenever he did stuff for World of Sport, but he was the first Tiger Mask. The smoothest wrestler you will ever see in your life is Sammy Lee. Like, he would do stuff. His whole gimmick was he was dressed like Bruce Lee. And, you know, because of course, back then racism was super prevalent.
Everybody was
it's like, hey, here's an Asian guy. Let's name him Lee and dress him like Bruce Lee. yeah. So, but he, you know, he does the Bruce Lee stance where he kind of that Tekken style, like bob up and down with the feet going and like the Muhammad Ali style footwork. And, but some of the most beautifully clean and smooth grapples you'll ever see. Like he'll do stuff. It's almost like a breakdance move whenever he's out there and you're like, God, this guy's good. Like this guy's on one of those levels that, you know, and even Bret Hart said that Sammy Lee was the best guy he was ever in the ring with. So like, and that's a match I need to go back and watch is Bret Hart versus Tiger Mask in New Japan. that type of stuff. I think that type of stuff's making a comeback. And like we've talked about before, I think there is room for all kinds of professional wrestling now. You know, you have Puro, you have, you know, your New Japan strong style, King's Road stuff. Then you have the WWE style. Now you have American indies with like Chikara and Ring of Honor. And then you have UK indies like Revolution Pro and Progress and Beyond. And then you have like stuff from Ireland, ICW. And then you have Australian wrestling. And like, and it's all slightly different. And now you got guys coming in from China, which is really rare. You know, they don't even have full formal training there yet. But these guys are coming and they're good.
So this brings up what Todd brought up on again my new Discord channel. Todd brought this up when the UK tournament was announced that he's excited that the prospect of international territories becoming a thing, and that WWE is going to like basically take reins of it. So like how he just had the Cruiserweight Classic. Now we're having the UK tournament. Mm-hmm. So you think that they're going to make like all these different types of tournaments, but like to establish like WWE Dubai or WWE China, like WWE, like Australia or something like that. Yeah. Just to have like athletes come in and train and you'll get like the best of like that continent or whatever. Mm-hmm. You think that'll be like where it's going?
Oh yeah, and I think that's the smartest way to do it, because now your prospects that are getting over on the WWE network now get signed to WWE contracts because they have proof that the fans have watched these people's matches
from beginning of their first start and
and that's kind of the big deal right now, and this is sort of I know. It seems like every episode we kind of delve in a little bit to like the future of wrestling and like, where's this business going? But I think there is something super important with seeing the quote unquote start. I saw when Finn Balor first came to NXT and he was Hideo Itami's tag team partner. And Hideo Itami was like, I brought a friend with me. And then Finn Balor comes out and I saw his very first match in NXT. Well, keep in mind, he's been wrestling for 11 years prior to this. But to a lot of people, they knew who Finn Balor was before he went to WWE. You know what I mean? Like, they don't even know who Prince Devitt is. They don't know that his first name's Fergal. They don't know, you know, he came from Japan and all this stuff. They just know him as Finn Balor from the WWE network. So they still have that attachment of, I knew them before they were cool.
Yeah.
And I think that's what they're going for, is they're signing talent that they know can work. I mean, you look at a Pete Dunne or a Martin Scroll or Trent Seven match and holy shit, these guys can go. But a lot of American fans don't know who they are. And I think giving them this bigger stage on kind of the Pinnacle brand. The only thing I wish would happen is that they would be less worried about trying to get them to do the WWE style of wrestling. Have the guys work less, still give them a guaranteed contract. If they want to pick up more shifts, they can. But let them work their own style. Like, actually introduce these fans to what, you know, King's Road or Strong Style or British Strong Style or Shoot or Catch Wrestling or give him something. Like, give them variety. I think that's what's going to be, because if everyone just wrestles exactly the same way on the WWE Network, then what's the point of any of it, in my opinion? Like,
yeah.
You have this platform. Like, or hell, do one better and just show, like, Revolution Pro pay-per-views on the WWE Network.
Right.
Like, just straight up be like, oh, of course they won't get, like, Ring of Honor or anybody. I think Ring of Honor is too big. They would ask for too much money. You know, like, they have the talent to ask for that money. But the same thing with New Japan. There's no way WWE Network's going to get American rights to New Japan. No way in hell. But they could get American rights to Progress or Beyond. Mm. Or, you know what I mean? They could actually get these indies, put them on. That way, they have an influx of content from people that don't even directly need to be on their payroll. They just pay the promotion. Hey, we're going to give you, per pay-per-view, we're going to give you guys $300,000 a pay-per-view. Mm-hmm. Split it out among whoever is working the show. That's up to the booker. You know, here are the rules that we want you to abide by. No headshots because of our investors. You know, no pile drivers, no whatever. But still allow them to work a little more stiff. Don't make them wrestle 8 matches a week. You know, like, let them do their pay-per-view and maybe 2 appearances a month. That way they can work a little more stiff. They can show a different style of things. I think that's going to be really important going forward for kind of the future of evolving the business and the perception of it. And I think WWE Network should be, if you want to watch pro wrestling, turn on the WWE Network. Like, that's where I think it should be. The Netflix. It should be Netflix for wrestling. Watch the old NWA tapes. Well, you know, and they've kind of done it with WCW. You can watch every, you know, WCW pay-per-view. I think they have some Monday Nitros on there. You know, like old school SmackDowns and Raw. Like, have it truly be a full on-demand service, but not only just for the old stuff, have new incoming indies, like, show off their stuff. Or maybe twice a year, an indie gets booked to do a live WWE Network special.
Yeah, kind of like how they brought in ECW for, like, when, I think when they were in the Hammerstein Ballroom.
Yes, the one night only. There. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so like, when the ECW first invaded, and then when Jerry Lawler was having a feud with ECW type of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that's how they brought them in and showcased what they can do. And then ECW got bigger because of that. You can definitely do that with other promotions if they have a good working relationship with WWE.
Yeah. Yeah, no. I think it's interesting. We're at this weird crossroads because, you know, everyone's going to say, oh, once Vince McMahon is gone, then, you know, the business will completely change. And I don't think that's true. I think WWE is number one for a reason. I think they were smart enough to do business the way that they have been, you know, where their people are independent contractors, not employees. You know, they make as much money as their merch sales. So it's like this meritocracy of, well, if you can draw money, you're going to make a lot of money. But if you can't, we don't have much for you. That's kind of how the business is always going to run. I don't see it becoming this unionized, you know what I mean? Like, I don't think it's going to just overnight become a thing to where I'm going to go to college and study pro wrestling. And then I'm going to go and I'm going to get my, you know, I got my bachelor's degree in it. It's never going to be anything like that. Like, we're talking about carnies through and through. Like, this is going to be carnies forever. But I do think that the options might grow a little bit for, I don't know, taking more of these independent things under their wing.
Yeah.
I think there's more future for that. And I hope that's where they go with it. Because then you have to think, you essentially just tripled your roster without having to do anything.
Yeah. Exactly.
You know, now people, if they want to watch the live, you know, Beyond pay-per-view, hey, WWE Network, it's still $9.99 a month. Or honestly, they could even do a quote-unquote deluxe version to where $9.99 a month, you have everything WWE, WCW, and ECW. for $17.99 a month, you get access to on demand for these five independent promotions.
I believe they're playing around with that idea right now.
Yeah.
Because Ring of Honor and TNA were part of that plan, but I think Ring of Honor and TNA, well, because TNA is fine for now. They're not in dire straits. They are getting dire straits of money, but not as bad as it was like a couple months ago.
Right.
They were a couple months ago. They were part of that plan of getting all these other indie promotions to showcase like their archives. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. They're toying around with that idea. I think they may be tinkering with it. Maybe other promotions that again have a good working relationship with WWE. Mm-hmm. So you still may see that into fruition, because when they had the tier subscriptions happening, then I think that's where it's going to fall on. The premier tier you're going to get all these indie promotions as well. And then, it's going to be interesting.
Yeah. I'm excited to see where it goes.
Yeah.
But that's good stuff. Good stuff. I think that'll do it for this week. We literally had no idea what we were going to talk about except for the one question before we started.
Yeah.
And I feel pretty solid with how
it's a good start.
Yeah. You know,
it's a good start.
We started with Dusty Rhodes.
I watched the entirety of Final Fantasy Brotherhood.
Oh yeah. How'd you like that?
Yeah. I liked it. I like it a lot, actually. It's because you know how we were talking about in Final Fantasy 15, like just the way how Noctis looked, like, oh, this guy's totally emo. He's the Squall, right? Or something like that. I was like, totally judge the book by its cover. He's not even like that. He's picky about his food.
Sure. Yeah. Poor Ignis is like, let me try this again.
Yeah, exactly. Like Ignis is trying to just, just mold him into like to be a good proper adult in the real world, but like Noctis is like royalty, so like he's gonna be picky on things. And then I liked all the character stories of like how Prompto got into like the relationship with Noctis. Oh dude, I didn't even know he was fat.
Exactly. And you know what? Awesome. I was real proud of Square for going there. Because that's not the type of character development you usually see in a Square Enix or hardly any video games, really. Exactly, it's normally like, I used to be the emperor's blah, 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 but then I was outcast from my society. Like, it's all this hoity-toity bullshit. Like, the world demands us to be... Like, no, here's a kid. Growing up, he was overweight. People made fun of him.
Mm-hmm.
Then a guy, this kid that he met was nice to him. And then they became friends.
Yeah.
That's it. That's all you need. Like, that's the story, man. Like, you don't need all this highfalutin bullshit. Brothers. Yeah. Like, that's it. And that's how actual relationships start. Like, it's none of this grand emperor wizardry. Like, who cares about all that shit? Like, show the people. And now,
just me going off of the anime, I don't know who my favorite is right now. Because they're all cool. Yep. All good. So, like, once I get into the game, then I'll probably make a clear decision. But everybody's pretty even in my book.
They're all solid, and there are plot twists and all that stuff in the game. Characters may be kind of deceiving, which is a really interesting thing, because I think that this cast, as far as Final Fantasy casts, are the most grounded in reality.
Cool.
They're very much like, the reason why these people did these things makes sense because I've known people to do that type of thing. You know, like it's not trying to go above and beyond and saving the whole universe and all this stuff. You know, we would always make fun of Japanese role-playing games, and you and I both love these things, right? But it was always teenagers saving the world. That's what all of them are.
Pretty much.
16-year-old kid, but the fate of the free world is in their hands. Like, no, get out of here. But this one, it's not like that. And Brotherhood, I think, is a great primer because, yeah. And they all four have way different personalities, which is mm-hmm. another thing. Like, I was very impressed with how well-rounded every character was. I think that's the biggest accomplishment from that game.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah. Yeah, good. So I'm glad you liked it. Like it's something yeah. different. You go and expected yeah, one thing yeah. and then you leave and you're like, wait a minute. Like this was a pleasant surprise.
No, it's kind of like the, forgetting what the Final Fantasy anime was, of 7, where it was about Zack and it showed yes. Zack being a total badass. Yep. Yeah. It was kind of like that. It was cool. So,
oh,
yeah.
Before Crisis or something like that. Like,
yeah, like that.
Yeah, because the game was Crisis Core, which was also very yeah. good. But yeah, that right, whole so, yeah.
I'm gonna fastball recommend ooh. Something for you. So
ooh, mm-hmm.
So you know how I gave you the three choices of like a couple weeks ago?
Yes.
The one choice was One Punch Man, and basically I just wanted you to check that one out.
Okay.
Yeah, check out right. One Punch Man. Action-packed, funny.
Gotcha. Okay, so yeah, and One Punch Man, is it on like Crunchyroll or is it that
it
way?
It is not on Crunchyroll.
Okay.
You would have to basically just Google that and see where you can find it.
See where it is. Gotcha.
Yeah. Okay,
so that way if people at home want to join us on the yeah. adventure of One Punch Man, they can yeah. also figure out where to go for it. But yeah, man, One Punch Man, because I've heard
12 episodes.
Oh,
in one yeah. season. So it's
good deal.
Yeah, it's pretty straightforward. Yeah. You can finish it in a day.
Oh, awesome. And is it just the one season?
Right now it's just the one season. And okay. I think like there's other specials, but I think it's like a recap of what happened.
Gotcha.
Maybe a little extra stuff, okay. but yeah, that's about it.
Because I've heard a lot of hype about it. Like message boards I go to, like people are way into it. Mm-hmm. It seems like cult following isn't the right term, but it's an actual following. But like the fans that are into it yeah. are way into it. Like they're all in.
Like it's like an unexpected darling.
Yeah, right. Yeah. That seems to be about the case from what people have told me about it, but that, yeah, yeah that's awesome. I will check out One Punch Man and I urge everyone out there in listener land to do the same. That way we can yeah. talk shop about it next week. Cool. Yeah. But I think that'll do it. For this episode, episode number, which one is this one? 10 or 11?
We'll be on.
One of those.
I'm so. Starting to get confused myself, but I think we're at 11.
Okay. Yeah, I think so too. Good work, team. Yeah. We are yeah. now well into double digits.
Woo.
Yeah. Next
so
one
let's
is episode.
Try to get two questions in.
Yeah. Next right. and you know what? We'll actually do open call for every episode. Like, send us, yeah.
send us
like
questions
regardless. Like if we get bombarded
topics,
with
questions, yeah.
Yeah, comics, video games, wrestling, anything. Relationships. Yeah. We could turn Terrace House on you.
Oh, dude.
We could tell you like, I brought that meat home as a gift.
Oh.
I brought it home as a gift. Why could you do this?
Okay. I have a request for you. Yeah. Please. I'm not sure how the rules state in terms of like finishing a podcast.
Okay.
If you can get the finishing song, the opening song was Harris House, I would be very grateful to close the show.
To close the show.
Very grateful. Yeah.
Oh man. Okay.
let's throw a curveball.
We're gonna throw that curveball. You know what? We're gonna make magic happen right now.
There you go.
Yeah, I'm gonna count that as a question from Mr. Marco Flores from Nerd in the Bay.
There you go.
Asks, is there a way that is humanly possible to end the podcast
the opening song.
With the opening song. Now, what is this called?
Okay, hang on. I had the song. I was totally serious. I had the song. Hang on.
Let's call it.
Hang on.
I found the whole Spotify playlist.
Okay, so it's called Slow Down by Matthew Heath.
Okay.
And I think Matthew Heath, Grady Griggs.
Okay.
It's called Slow Down.
Just Slow Down. Okay, perfect.
Yeah.
So I have the Brethren Around theme playing right now, but here we go.
There you go.
I'm going to try this. I'm going to try this. Let's let this magic happen.
Yeah.
Oh, let's do it. Let's do it. All right, guys. That's our time. we will see you guys next week for the newest installment of Brother and I. Be sure, hey, get your... Oh, there it is. There it's going.
Yes.
So good. We'll see you guys next week. Bye. Moving to my own drum, leave before the sun comes. I was gonna make this count. Bleeding for the sake of someone else's pay stub. Hoping this would all work out. But I've been stealing time, thinking if I try, everything would turn out right. We're caught up in the climb, love was far behind. Someone's gotta stop this madness. When all this seems like it's okay, and all we feel is dead stick, we're on replay. And all these dreams where lives fade are leaving out the people that we love. So slow down, we need to slow down. Feel it when the sun comes, feel it when you're. Everybody needs more time to step into the sunshine, see it with your own eyes. I just wanna feel alive. Cause I've been killing time, I was losing life. I've been here for no good reason. We're caught up in the climb, love was far behind. Someone's gotta stop this madness. When all gotta spend it right. No one's got a hold on you as long as you're still alive. No one's got a hold on time. We just gotta spend it right. No one's got a hold on you as long as you're still alive.